let's get started with our service today. So some of our announcements, some of the usual ones, if you'd like to give, you can give in the boxes at the back, or you can give online through PayPal on our website. We are continuing our 100 days of prayer. Today is day 71. If you have any prayer requests, you can either put them on the back wall over here. If you want to keep them a little bit more anonymous, you can put them in the boxes in the back, and we will be praying for those. Camp is not this coming week, but the week after. So if you have a young person that would like to go to camp, please let us know and we'll get them ready. This week is our state meeting for Real Baptists. So we will not be having church on Wednesday, and we will not be having men's Bible study on Tuesday. But that is all the announcements we have for this week. Kara, would you pray for us, please?
Gracious Lord, Heavenly Father, we are so thankful to be in your house as we come together to worship you, Lord. Father God, I pray that you would prepare our hearts to receive your word. Father God, I pray for Evan as you have brought him here this morning to bring us our message, Lord. I pray that you would just use him. And we are so grateful for him and the ministry that he has and his love for you. Father God, use us, use this church, Lord, that we just might reach out to the lost and build your kingdom. Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray, amen.
Let's stand. We've got scripture to read. It comes from Psalm 147, verses 1 through 5. Praise the Lord. How good to sing praises to our God. How delightful and how fitting. The Lord is rebuilding Jerusalem and bringing the exiles back to Israel.
Here I am, lifting up my heart. If you call the raging sea, you can calm a storm in me. You're never too far. Hold my heart the same. Whenever I fall away, whenever I start to break, so here I am, lifting up my heart. If you can calm the raging sea, you can calm the storm. Holds the stars.
Ephesians 6, verses 17 through 18. No, wait, no, this is John. 1 John 4, 9 through 11. God showed us how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love, not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins.
Redeeming love has been my theme.
Oh, that's true. Do we start all over? No. We were cutting honeysuckle, by the way. I'd never want to see that vile weed again, whatever it is. But we worked for about 3 hours. And I have to admit, you know, most days I feel real good. I felt 63 yesterday. We were cutting on that stuff, and I don't know how I had mud on me. I don't know why I don't remember falling down or anything, but I was filthy. Sweat was pouring off, and I was just, it was just disgusting. Now, here's the point, okay? It felt so good, and you know what that's like after you've worked hard and you've done all of that, to go to take the shower and let that water just wash you clean. Some people find the blood of Jesus offensive. Think that we shouldn't talk about that. That is our song. That is the theme. We are nothing unless He washes our sins away and makes us right and holy. I have no standing with God, no hope without Him. So I'm thankful that the blood of Jesus Christ still washes sins away, that it is still powerful today. And I hope you are too. Well, I'm not preaching today, so I'll stop. It's good to have Evan back from Oklahoma today. I was going to say from school, but now he's kind of made Oklahoma his home. He probably says boomer sooner all the time now. I don't know. But anyway, we're glad to have Evan back, and I've asked him to come and share God's word with us today. Looking forward to that. It's always good to have him here. And so you listen as God speaks through him. And as he comes, we're going to dismiss the kids to go back to kids' church. Get that book. But we're going to listen as he comes to preach. And just before he starts, I'm going to ask Ken, if you would, to lead us in prayer and prepare our hearts to listen to God's word this morning.
Well, it's definitely good to be home, even though it's been a while. It's always a blessing to get to come back and speak, and I know it's not a right, and it's a privilege, and I appreciate that completely. If you would like to turn to Acts chapter 16, start in verse 22, that's where we'll be today, if I'm able to get through it. Where I want to begin is, you know, I titled this message, Christ Through It All, dramatic change. And here at the church, very soon, there's going to be some very big dramatic change. It's good change. I mean, I can't say how honored and blessed I am to have been able to learn and watch Adam and Steve and to see them continue to follow God's path that he's laid out for them, and to have the courage to do that is just amazing, and I can't tell you how honored I am to see them do that. But at the same time as well, there's going to be change at Rejoice, and there's going to have to be an effort from everyone in the church to continue to bless the community, to continue to grow, to bring the youth into the church, to be who the church wants to be, is going to have to be a collective together. Sorry, I got stumbled on my own words. It's going to have to be a collective effort, is what I was trying to say. A collective effort to be able to grow, to be able to be in biblical growth. Because you can grow and it be unbiblical. You can be tiny, be a five-person church and be biblical. But the whole point about it is to be biblical and to grow biblically, it has to be change in you before it can be changed outside in your church, in the church, or outside in your community. And it also has to be a commitment in leadership, a commitment in the people to raise up the ones under them to be able to be next. And so that's why I wanted to start in Acts chapter 16 and verse 22. Because here we see, you know, Paul and Silas are walking through, and there a woman is kind of tormenting them, and she's kind of, you know, giving them a hard time, and you know, they're just trying to preach and spread the word of God, and you know, she's been, you know, telling fortunes, and you know, Paul tells the devil to leave her, and then so now that her masters can't make money from her anymore, they decide to have Paul and Silas arrested and thrown into prison. And after they're beaten and flogged and humiliated in front of the public, they throw them in prison. And before I read in verse 22, I want to be sure to tell you that there's three points I want to go through today about change and how to do change positively and biblically. And that is, one, you have to have the right attitude. Second, you have to be correct in your patience and then your time management. And three, you have to be willing to accept what is different and what is new, and be willing to be uncomfortable and not have it your way, but have it the way that is effective biblically and the way that God has called it to be. So I'm going to go ahead and start in verse 22. The crowd joined in the attack, and Paul and Silas and the magistrates ordered them to be stripped and beaten with rods. After they had been severely flogged, they were thrown into prison, and the jailer was commanded to guard them carefully. When he received these orders, he put them in the inner cell and fastened their feet in the stocks. That is very uncommon. For as locked down as Paul and Silas were, why that is uncommon and that's great to mention out is because the jailer in this story is, if they escape, if they leave, that's the end of his life. And back in the time of Rome, if you were a jailer or a Roman soldier, if you failed in your mission or in your appointment, then that would mean you have failed Caesar, you have failed Rome, and that would mean the end of your life because of your failed, you have dishonored Rome, you've dishonored your people. So the reason that they were so locked down was because, you know, this is such a high profile, you know, preacher, high profile, they're in here inciting riots, inciting change. And so for him, he didn't have any room for any air. So we had to make sure that they were locked down. And so as we continue, about midnight, Paul and Silas were praying and singing hymns to God, and the other prisoners were listening to them. Suddenly, there was such a violent earthquake to them. There was such a violent earthquake that the foundations of the prison were shaken. At once, all the prison doors flew open, and everyone's chains came loose. The jailer woke up, and when he saw the prison doors open, he drew his sword and was about to kill himself because he thought the prisoners had escaped. But Paul shouted, "Don't harm yourself. We are all here." The jailer called for the lights, rushed in trembling, and before Paul and Silas, he then brought them out and asked, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And that's beautiful because it wraps up all three points. Because one, Paul and Silas' attitude was correct. Because they were jailed, had just been publicly beaten, flogged, spit on, humiliated. and they're in prison singing hymns. They're in prison rejoicing in God because of who he is and what he does, not because of their circumstances and where they're at and what they're going through, but because of who God is. See, their happiness might have been affected, but their joy wasn't affected. And that's one thing that a lot of people don't focus on, is that idolatry can come in the form of joy. Because if your joy isn't in God, if your joy, because joy is secured in Christ, if it isn't in God, then you're in idolatry. Your happiness isn't promised, but your joy is promised, because your joy is supposed to be wrapped up in who Christ is. And see, their joy was in Christ. So to them, what they had gone through was nothing. It was, for them, it was a privilege for them to be beaten. It was a privilege for them to have the opportunity to lose their life for Christ, because it meant they did it to advance the gospel. It means they did it so that God's kingdom could grow. And two, their timing. The doors flew open. They could have left. And that's the thing, is so many of us that go through something or are going through a troubling time, and if it's family, if it's ministry, every time that we get an escape, we like to fly away or get out as quick as possible. But what we learn from Paul and from Silas is that it's God's timing. He wasn't ready for them to leave yet. And as you continue on through your chapter, you see that this jailer and his family were able to be saved and learn who Christ was. But if they had skipped out on God's timing, if they had placed themselves in their timing, they would have never known who Christ was. This man would have took it in his own life and never been able to see the grace of God. But because they were willing to sacrifice, willing to be hurt after they had already been hurt publicly, they were able to see a man and his family come to know who Christ is. And is that not the whole point? Is sacrifice and dedication to who God is not the point? Is the cross not what we live for? But the thing that amazes me, though, about Paul and Silas isn't even about their timing. It comes to me about their patience. Their patience with the people. Their patience with continuously, no matter where they go, being thrown in jail, being beaten, not just here, but everywhere. They have so much patience wrapped up inside of them, so much so that no matter where they go, they're willing to start from square one. They're willing to build off of that. They're willing, the same people that beat them, they're willing to go and pray for them. They're willing to go and take them a meal. They're continuously asking for resources and asking for churches' support to save the same people who want to take their life. If that isn't the ultimate picture of patience, I don't know what is. And they were willing to accept change. They were willing to accept change in the form of this man who just jailed them when they were innocent, supported their beating. They were willing to accept his change. He said, "How do I come to know the Lord?" And some of us, if he had just been flogged and whipped and chained and drugged in front of the entire community of people, you know, and then this man comes falling to your knees asking, "How do I be saved?" A lot of us probably would walk away. But they didn't. Because they knew his heart was worth it. They knew that their physical pain, their emotional pain, was nothing compared to the joy that they have in Christ. That the joy overran what else. And so I think that that is a major element in faith, is that being willing to accept the change, being willing to accept other people's change. But also there's another element to that. Knowing when not to accept change. Because not every change is biblical. And in the coming months, when there's a lot of change here, there's going to have to be a dedication to prayer, a dedication to study. And people are going to have to fill roles and come in and going to have to be willing to sacrifice time. East are going to have to be willing to come in and say, okay, I'm going to take control of that, or I'll be willing to help. Because if there is something, if you want to survive, if you want to be able to grow and be able to show who God is biblically and be able to honor him, and in this church body, it's going to take a collective effort. It's going to take more than just your vision and what you see for it. It's going to have to be, God, what do you want from me? What do you want from the people here? And what can we do to accomplish it? And you're going to have to pray and actually listen. You're not just going to have to be able to pray and study enough that your conscience is clear. You're going to have to actually do the work and put in the work and listen to what God's trying to say, even if that means it's uncomfortable. And I've had to learn that so many times the hard way. I've had to tell myself that your vision, I've placed my vision in front of what God's is and told myself that that's God's vision, that this is what God wants from me. And I have to step back and realize what I'm doing and realize who I'm being, because it's so easy to get ahead of yourself and to say, I'm living for God, but you're really just coasting. Because so many of us, we go and we pray before our meals. We, you know, we read a nice verse, or you know, we see a nice video on Facebook and we've watched it or we shared it. And so now, you know, we've done enough that my conscience is clear, because you know I've served God today, you know, at least an hour or two. So my conscience is clear, but I'm not in the will of God, because if it was truly about the will of God, our entire day is dedicated to God. Because so many people say, I spend time with God, but not a lot of people say, God owns my time. It's either God owns your time or you spend time with God, and they're completely different. Because when you say, I spend time with God, you're saying, oh, you know, a nice prayer, a nice meal. But when you say, God owns my time, then you're saying, okay, I'm ready to do what you want me to do. That means work, school, church, wherever it is, that means God owns my time. That means that it doesn't matter if it's in the car. It doesn't matter if that's in the middle of public. If God is asking me to do it, I have to be dedicated towards it. And so especially in times of change, in times of brokenness, God has to own your time. You can't recover, you can't grow in your faith if God doesn't own your time, if God doesn't own your patience, if your joy isn't in Christ. That's why in 1 John, when John's going about talking about, you know, what is the mark of a true Christian? The mark of a true Christian is complete ownership of God. It's completeness of you just can't accept anything less than God being in total control of your life. It's a Christian who is just desperate for the return of Christ, desperate for God to do work in his life and his family's life. But so many Christians, so many of us, I'll say of us because I'm in the same boat. So many of us, we just want to clear our conscience. We just want to be, you know, enough that, you know, I've prayed and I've been forgiven. You know, I've backslidden for a little bit of time, but now I've prayed and now I'm clear. Or, you know, I haven't really been studying, but these last 2 days, you know, I've really gotten after it 1 or 2 hours a day. And so my conscience is clear and I'm ready. And so, God, you know, God's got me. And, you know, we all just say, you know, nobody's perfect. But the thing is that going to be done being an excuse? Nobody's perfect. We get that. But when are you going to start striving for it? When are you going to stop saying, well, you know, everyone makes mistakes, and start saying, I'm done making mistakes. God, show me what to do so I can be more like you. And stop accepting failure and start accepting Christ. And I've had to learn that lesson more than once. Many of you know my story, and I'm not going to get into it today, but many of you know my story and know what I've been through and, you know, the choices that I made. And a lot of us would have the same story. We could come up here and say a lot of the same things. But the only thing that made my different than a lot of others is that finally, after probably the millionth time when Christ called, I actually answered. And that's the thing, that's going to make a lot of this different here, is that when God calls, it's going to be who's going to answer. Who's going to say, it's me? I'm not going to wait and watch and someone else say it's me and then I'll join. No, I'm going to say, God, it's me. What do you need me to do? What do I need to do at Rejoice? What do I need to do in Columbia? What do I need to do to help Missouri grow past a 1% attendance rate at church every Sunday? And the crazy thing is that a lot of these numbers, Christians don't know. A lot of these statistics about failing church, about how African Americans are the biggest branch of Christians that are leaving the church, don't know, because people don't dedicate themselves to research. We know is that we all talk about how good God is. We all talk about how great God is when it's brought up. But you don't see the joy of God in people's lives anymore. You don't see people actually being dedicated to who he is. They're just dedicated to the thought of who he is. And the thing that's so beautiful about Paul and Silas, and the thing that I love to learn from Paul, is that Paul, my goodness, Paul doesn't take it easy on himself. He's, like Steve said earlier, he called himself the chief of sinners. Paul dealt with grave sin his entire life. Paul dealt with guilt and shame. But the thing is Paul didn't stop there. Paul knew he was cleaned by who God was, but Paul also didn't forget who he was and who owned him. But the problem with a lot of us, and myself included, is we like to take it easy on ourselves because when we get that point, when we get that opportunity to flee, we like to flee. We don't like to be in God's timing. We don't like to stick around in pain and in hurt and ask God, what do you need me to do in this pain? You've given it to me. I told you that I gave you my life. So that means that you've put me here for a reason. That means that there's something you need me to do. But we don't ask that. We just think when there's an opportunity to flee, we think that it's God saying go. But we didn't ask God if he said go. Because a lot of the times God's saying stop. I need you there. Same thing he did with Job. He told Job, he said, I interact with the whole universe. He said, if I put you in poverty and I put you in riches, it's not about you. Job, you told me your life was mine. I'm just using it how I please to. Same thing with Habakkuk. He said, God, tell me what you're doing. He said, if I told you, he would say you would call me a liar. He said, I do things that you couldn't ever comprehend. So to me, it just gets funny when I try to say, that I comprehend God or I know what God's trying to tell me to do when I don't. I don't at all. I'm blessed and honored to have the ability to preach this message and to be here. And I can't tell you the honor it is to be able to be in front of you and to speak. And the thing about that is this is taken for granted. This won't be forever. Being in this building, being here, being able to listen to a message, being able to hear the gospel, it won't last forever. There will be a time of judgment. There will also be a time where it might not be free for us to do what we do. And the thing is, we have to stop taking it for granted. We have to start knowing it's okay to be broken, knowing it's okay to change, but knowing that it's also okay to be prepared. And that now is the time to start fighting for people, start fighting for yourself as well. Stop letting yourself get run down and not experiencing who God is. Stop being so long away from prayer. Stop doing superficial prayers. Don't be afraid to get deep. Be bold when you go to Christ. He told you to be bold. He said, ask me for anything. And why did he say that? Because there's nothing he can't do. He might say no. So don't think that God's not listening or you're doing something wrong just because he says no. But be willing to listen why he says no. Because I've learned, you know, a lot of pastors say, you know, he says no, he says yes. But I've learned God tells me why he says no or why he says yes. And he tells me in a form of opening doors. One of the greatest things I learned from my mentor, Dr. Thomas Marbury, who unfortunately passed away this February. He told me, he said, God in my life, he's never done anything crazy. I've never gotten a vision. I've never been, you know, struck by lightning. He said, God has opened and closed doors in my life that you wouldn't believe. And the greatest piece of advice that he ever gave me when I was coming into the ministry, he said, do all things for God. But he said, if you're not doing it for God, he said, you better just grab a chair and sit in the corner because it's not worth it. So the point of that is examine your life. See what is for God and what isn't. See what you do and why you do it. Don't just do it anymore. Don't just operate in a manner of which it's about you or, you know, it's about looking for happiness or, you know, the funny thing to me is they always say, we're in 2021, still no closer to finding life's ultimate question. That's garbage. The life's ultimate question, the answer to that is what life is about. It's getting to know the Lord Jesus Christ and being able to serve him and honor him and glorify him. That's already been answered. So don't believe the world when they tell you that, you know, you got to focus on you for a season or you got to be worried about you and your family worried about you because it's not about you. You chose to accept Christ. You said, Christ, come into my life. Be my Lord. So use your life for him. If you want to be a part of him and you want to follow him, then do what you said you would do. And I know that's the hardest thing. It's easy to stand here and say it, but it's so much harder to live it. But the thing about it is when you start living it, you won't believe what happens when you do. You won't believe what happens when you walk away from the things that make you feel comfortable and you step into the things that make you uncomfortable. When God turned my life around, the things I've seen even to this day happen in my family, happen in my friends, I couldn't repay them for. The things I've seen God do with the people in my life, with this church, with just countless strangers, the things I've seen him do, I'm so grateful for it and so honored. And I thank this church for all that they've done for me and this community and all that they've done and honoring God and sticking with me and Steve and Adam and everyone just continuously, you know, not giving up and allowing God to use them to speak to me. And I can never repay that. But the thing about it is that will go down the drain if I don't continue to live for who God is. That will be a waste. All the tears in the world won't mean a thing if I don't serve God for who he is. Because I can cry as much as I want. I can be beaten as much as I want. But it means nothing if I do it for Evan. It means nothing if you do it for yourself. The reason being is because we're all failures. The reason being why we have to sit here and talk about correction and talk about having a good attitude, having good timing, having patience, being able to accept change, is because we continuously fail. So we need to stop. We need to stop putting ourselves in a place of hierarchy and judgment, and putting ourselves in a place where we're coasting. Because we have to do this because we fail. We should be able to stand here and just praise God and talk about how good He is, but we have to have sermons, and we have to have time of learning and growth, because we are continuously failing. We are continuously breaking down good things. And that's all of us. Because we shouldn't have to do this. I shouldn't have to be broken in myself and listening to my own words and being like, man, yeah, that's me. It's disappointing. And that's the human condition. That's because we're flesh. So let that be there a reminder that you have no right to anything. You have no right. You have no right to say, you know, this is my money, this is my car, this is my church, this is my, you know, this is my past. No right to anything. Let it become God's, and then God can do something with it. Because the thing is God already has it, but He's going to let you say it's yours for a while. He's going to let you say that, and then finally He's going to let you come around and say, oh, it's been His the whole time. So many of us walk around with a chip on our shoulders. You know, it's easy to get done with a good message or to get done with a good study and have a nice chip on your shoulder. But the thing about it, at the end of it is, I always get reminded that the reason I got that chip on my shoulder is because I failed at it before. And I know I'll fail at it again. And that right there to me is one of the biggest problems with my attitude, is that I love to get a big head. I love to find something new and God opens something up to me, and I love to get a big head and be like, I gotta go write a sermon or make a video on this one, and you know, God's really gonna do something here. He's gonna change everybody's life. And then when God decides to do something different, you know, I don't like to listen because I already got my head going where it wants to go. I already got myself positioned where I positioned myself instead of where God is telling me to go. You know, and change isn't just in the church. Change is also in our lives, in our personal lives. Some of us, you know, we put a prayer request in a box. We raise our hand during prayer time. But in reality, no one really knows how deep some of the pain goes. Some of us don't realize that some of us sitting here today are dying inside. And some of us don't know of that at all. And the thing that comes with that is, don't do it alone. Don't experience change alone. You're here today for a reason. God brought you here today for a reason. Don't experience it alone. Don't, if you're, some of us, you might not have a supporting family. Don't do it alone. Call me. Call somebody. Because the worst thing you can do is go through change and not do it with God. Because when you change, things around you change. Your family adapts to it. The community adapts to it. The church adapts to it. Allow God to facilitate in you what He wants to do. Allow God to have control of your time, your attitude. Allow God to say, you know, I know you failed in this area, but I'm going to work with you on it. But be willing to work on it. Be willing to walk away from situations. Be willing to say, God, it's not worth it. Be willing to do that. Because many of us, we can have a false commitment. A lot of us do. with so easy. It's so easy to say, I'm committed to God, but then nothing about you changes. It's so easy to say, I want my marriage to be better, but you're waiting on your wife or your husband to complete your happiness, and that's never going to happen. So many of us, we want friendships, relationships to be better, but the thing about that is that it's never going to be better if in your marriage or in your relationship that you or that person is in the front of it. If God isn't in control, if you're not doing it biblically, if you're not living it biblically, you're going to continue to struggle. And the crazy thing about that is that now the divorce rate, Christians have the highest, Christians, social class of people, Christians have the highest divorce rate, over 50%. The divorce rate for non-Christians is 50%. We're somewhere closer to about 55, 60. And you know what's sad about that? Is that it just is evidence to a lot of false commitments. The problem with us isn't that the commitment is too hard, isn't that what God's asking is too hard. The problem is a lot of people don't want to give up who they are. And that's the biggest part of change, is that when you decide to follow God, when you decide to rededicate your life, or you decide that you're going to get serious now, you have to lose who you are. And so when people say, don't lose who you are, or, you know, be an individual, some of the stupid stuff I've ever heard in my life. Because you, your entire intention is to be who Christ is. So stop listening to motivational videos and quotes and start listening to the gospel. Because if you want to know who you're supposed to be, it's right there in Matthew. It's right there in Luke. Learn who Jesus is, and so you can learn who you are. If you want to be better, if you want your family to be better, if you want your walk to show others who Christ is, be willing to lose yourself. Be willing to walk away from the things that take you away from being like Christ. Be willing to be an outcast. Be willing to have others hate you. But, you know, and that's one of the greatest things I think that I've ever learned, is that it's okay to be hated. It's okay to be hated. Because then you get to turn around, you get to love them. Because so many people love to fight fire with fire, and so many people love to, you know, say, well, you know, I'm going to be strong. But when you get to that point where you get to say, man, they hate me, but man, I have so much love for them, there's beauty in that. In Oklahoma, I got, you know, I got like 6-7 brothers that just have become like family to me, and I love him so much. And, you know, just these past 2 years to see what God has done with them, and, you know, that in itself is beautiful. And, you know, I can't express enough how when you see change happen in your family's life, when you see dedication happen in the people around you, how beautiful that is. And all it really takes is you to start doing what you told Christ you would do when you accepted him. You know, I love being able to be here. I love being able to see you guys. But I wish, I hope that I would never have to come back and do it again. I wish that it would be, and I mean that in a positive way. I wish that, you know, Christ would work so hard in us that everyone in here just became a minister. But I don't have to come back and teach and redirect and, you know, have to open up, that just everyone, just say Christ would work so well in you, and we'd become so dedicated, so committed, that when we leave here today, instead of going to lunch, we just go and preach. But that's not reality, is it? Because we all know when we leave here, a lot of us are going to go home and we're going to make the same decisions that we made before we got here. We're going to go home and we're going to have to keep teaching and teaching and learning from our mistakes. Because a lot of the time, when we have a message of redirection, what we do is, that's not us. That's a Christian problem, but that's not me. That's a Free Will Baptist problem, but that's not me. But that's that is the problem. The thing is, when you can learn from the same lesson over and over again, that's when you're truly teachable. It's when it doesn't matter if you know that lesson, but it still teaches you something. That's being truly teachable. And examining Peter, you see that a lot. Peter has to keep learning the same lesson over and over again. And he was the leader of the apostles. But the thing about it is, he never quit learning. He never quit working on his attitude. And the thing about us is, if we quit, if we stop, if we stop being willing to change, who's going to share the gospel? Because mainstream Christianity is not going to do it. You know, non-Christians aren't going to do it. You know, a stranger's not going to change your marriage, change your relationship, change your schools, change the government. None of that's going to happen by just sitting here and complaining about it and saying a prayer or two every once in a while when you think about it. That's not how it works. It takes the groundwork and the people who love Christ to be involved. People should think you're annoying. People should quit inviting you to stuff because all you're doing is talking about Christ. And sooner or later, they're going to give you a phone call saying, hey, can you come back and tell me what you were talking about? I can't tell you how many times that's happened. But it has to be real. It can't be superficial. It can't be, I want this to be better. I want this to be stronger. But you're being fake about it. You're going into it with intentions, you know, looking for a little bit of fame or looking for, you know, a little bit of sympathy. It has to be real. It has to be where it's about Christ. Always about Christ. It has to even be that, you know, when you honor your wife, when you honor your brother, your sister, when you do that, it has to be because it's about Christ. It can't be anything about you. You have to put yourself so far aside. You have to place yourself in this place where you can be remolded, reshaped, and recrafted so that the selfishness, the jealousy is second nature. Instead of Christ being second nature and him having to be reintroduced, him having to be elevated in your life, he should already be elevated. He should already be the center of attention. You know, if we went through and examined our week and we saw what we talked about, I would, most likely in most of us, God would probably be about 1 to 2% of what we talked about this week. But then we claim to love him. We claim that he is the center of our life. But then why does the Bible say, you know, talk about Christ at all times and use words when necessary? But instead we talk about the world at most times and talk about Christ, you know, when it's easy or when it's going to get us something, it's going to advance us in, you know, a social circle, or when we want to feel uncomfortable and so they're talking about God, so we just sprinkle in a little bit of information so that they don't think we're bad Christians. so the church doesn't look down on us. But what a sad way to live. You could talk about God at all times, and we hardly ever do. We sacrifice so much for selfish things. And if we just sacrifice for Christ, the amazing things that would happen in your life. And I'm not talking about wealth. Not at all. That's never promised. I'm not talking about happiness. But I'm talking about seeing people know who Christ is. Because all this is here, Paul tells us clearly, we're just ambassadors. This isn't my home. You can have it. This isn't my place. This isn't my church. This isn't my pulpit. I'm just here. I'm just an ambassador. I'm just here trying to do what my Father's told me to do. And I don't do it perfectly. I don't do it the way he asked me to do it every single time. But I promise you, if we each commit to each other to do what Christ is asking us to do, to teach the gospel the way he's asking us to teach it, the change that would happen, it'd be so radical. You know, it would be so radical. And the thing that kills us with change is that usually the church is on the wrong side of it. The 70s, the church removed sex from the pulpit. And what happened? The world took sex over. And that's why it is what it is today. What happened in the 80s? The church walked away from the young people. Church got more about being a social environment. And what happened? We lost the young people in the 80s. 90s. The 2000s, the 2010s, continuously the church has walked away from another step, another stepping stone in the community. And we wonder why we continue to lose things. It's because we don't want to talk about things that are uncomfortable. Excuse me. We don't want to talk about things that people don't want us to talk about. We want to go to church and we want to have messages about how good you can be. God's going to bless your bank account. God's going to tell you, you know, your next steps in life. But you want that promotion? Okay, give the church $150. Literally, I mean, that might be a little blunt, but that's literally what Christianity is turning into. Because now people are starting to call that message out, so they're finding other ways to go around it. And they're calling it messages of blessing or they're calling it, you know, progressive Christianity. The thing that's so crazy about that is, as long as I've been alive, the Bible hasn't changed. As long as I've been around, Christ hasn't changed. So I want to know, how does Christianity turn progressive? Because in this book here, this is the most progressive thing you'll ever find. This is the most free and open thing you'll ever find is right here. But instead, we have corrupted ourselves with ideas that contradict God's vision. And we wonder why things are so broken. We wonder why people experience things that are not right or untrue. And they think it's because of, you know, people taking Christianity and being radical, but that's not it. It's taking Christianity, it's being misinterpreted. Because the thing is people, they don't want redirection or correction. What they want is they want to be sustained at where they're at and told they're doing what's right, being told they're given, you know, that God's going to be with them, but, you know, just stay here for a little bit, you know, but God's coming around the corner. Or, you know, God helps those who help themselves, or, you know, some other garbage like that. You know, and what is so painful about that is that you're seeing people that are really looking for help. and this mainstream Christianity, this new reform of what being a believer in Christ is turning into a joke, and it's turning these people that are really looking for help into just farther down a road of pain with no recovery, none whatsoever. You know, when a sermon in a church becomes more of a performance, there's something wrong. When it becomes just showing up, when it becomes not changing, when it becomes you not willing to instill different things inside of you, when it becomes just show up and be sustained at the level you're at because it's uncomfortable to grow. And the thing is people love to use that nice philosophical language, is that, oh, you know, we just need to grow right now, or we just need to be separated right now, or people say things like, you know, they have that nice little language that makes it seem like they really know what they're talking about, but they really don't. And what's crazy about that is that's everywhere. That's anywhere you go. It's going to be there. And the thing is, if you're not ready to combat it, I promise you, you're going to join it. Because so many Christians have come to this spot where they want to say, well, you know, God loves me, and I know that, I probably should stop doing this, or I probably should quit, or I probably should change, but, you know, I'm just not comfortable yet. You better get uncomfortable, because I promise you that God doesn't let you just sit somewhere. God's going to try as hard as he can to redirect you, but there will be a time when he'll say, you've walked away. I'm done. Because so many people say, God never leaves. God never leaves. That's true. God never leaves. But he'll let you walk. God's not going to waste his time. That's one thing I've learned, is God doesn't waste his time. God doesn't find you worthless. That's not what I'm saying. But what I am saying is God will let you make your decision. He loves you too much. God loves you so much. Scientifically, God is a self-sufficient being. To be God, scientifically, you can't add anything to him or take anything away from him. Think about that. When you give him praise, he has to choose to let you give him joy in that. When you're in pain, or when you make a mistake, God has to choose to let that hurt him, because you can't take or put anything away from him. He is self-sufficient by definition. Think, he loves you so much, he's willing to allow himself to be hurt, be broken over you, for you, purposely by his choice. That is the kind of loving God that you serve. So anything less than your 100% dedication is an absolute disrespect to him. And I have had to learn that time and time again. I've had to shed tears over that time and time again. It is an absolute disrespect to him without a 100% dedication, without a 100% commitment to change. And what's so beautiful about that is that he never asked for you to be perfect. He just asked for you to walk down the road. He knows you're going to fall off. He knows the road's going to have potholes in it. But he doesn't ask you to be perfect. He just asks you to pursue it. And what's so beautiful about that is there's no over faith in the world like that. He doesn't have any requirements. He doesn't have any, you need to do this. He just says, walk the road, and I'm going to walk in front of you. He doesn't ask you to go to Mecca. He doesn't ask you to pay to get out of purgatory. He says, just walk the road, and I'm going to walk before you, and I'm going to keep you safe. And if you can't see the beauty in that, if you can't see your life in that, I ask you to come find me, and let's dig into it in prayer. Talk with me. Talk with Steve. Talk with Adam. Don't just stay there. Because this is important. We're at a time in this church, especially with the transitions it's going through, and also in our community where it's fragile. We're at a breaking point. You have to make the decision now. It's time to be grown up. It's time to, you know, stop being baby Christians. And it's time to exercise that faith that you've been studying and praying and practicing and growing in. It's time now. It's time. So let's use that. Let's be a collective. Let's fight for other people. Let's stop just sustaining our faith, but let's start using that faith for other people. Let's start sharing. Let's start when people see us on the street, oh, that's that lady that always talks about God. That's that lady that's always trying to hand out cards for church. Because so many of us, no one could ever say that. Some of us, if you go to work, they don't even know you're a Christian. Let you become that outcast. But then let's see what happens when you become that outcast. Be the change. I remember that Barack Obama slogan, be the change you want to be. It's time. If you want something to happen, you have to be a part of it. You have to change your attitude. You have to practice patience. You have to be willing to be on God's timing. And then you have to be willing to accept change. You know, and as I get ready to close, the one thing that I want us to remember to take away from today is that you're never going to be perfect. You're never going to be sustained. You're never going to be fully satisfied, at least not in this life. But don't ever give up hope or the pursuit. Allow God to sustain you. Allow God to use you. Allow yourself to be in pain and to be hurt for other people. Allow yourself to dedicate your life to your enemies, because you once were the enemy of God. So allow yourself to be dedicated to loving those who hate you. Allow yourself to be dedicated to loving those who wouldn't do the same thing for you. But you do it for them because you don't do it for yourself. Because it's not about you, it's about Christ. So you dedicate yourself to other people. You treat other people better than you treat yourself. Why? Because I need them to know the gospel. I need them to know who Christ is. I got to do better. Don't stop. Don't hesitate. If you get caught up, you got the number to call. All you got to say is, "Dear Lord." Picks up the phone every time. He got a crazy minute plan. I'm telling you. Stay dedicated. Stay true. Stay real. And God can do things through you that you wouldn't believe. Stay true. Stay real. Believe in Him. Be willing to put yourself aside so that He can grow the gospel in you and in others, so that He can fix your marriage, He can fix your relationships. Be willing to say, okay, I've got to sit in the back seat. Not even in the passenger seat, I got to get in the back seat. I got to let God take control. I got to make sure that I'm living for others and that myself isn't even in the equation. And just remember that love that's given to you is given to everyone else. So help them know it as well. I'm going to close in prayer. Father, the words can't describe what a blessing it is to be here, to learn from you, to be able to be in joy just giving you praise, Father. What a blessing, Father, it is to know the name of the Lord. God, I ask that you protect this place. I ask that you protect the hearts in this place. God, I ask that you will work in our hearts and allow us, Father, to allow us to be become second. Allow us to put you at the top, Father. Allow us to put others in front of ourselves. Allow us, Father, to be so deeply in love with you, Father, that the ministry, that the love for spreading your gospel is the only thing that drives us. God, I pray that when we go to work, when we go to school, when we come to church, it's not about doing what we're supposed to do, or it's not about doing what makes us happy or reaching a goal, but it is about sharing the gospel at all times. It is about loving you at all times. God, I thank you for your commitment to me. I thank you for your commitment to this church. God, I thank you for everything that you've done in the lives of the people around me. I pray, God, that you just keep us safe and keep us on the path. And anyone in here struggling, anyone in here hurting, Father, I pray that you just encourage them to continue down the road as you go before them. You don't ask for them to be perfect. You don't ask for them to be sustained. You just ask for them to walk down the road, Father. And I just pray that they trust you enough to walk down that road, to walk it down in prayer. And God, I thank you again for how great you are. And I pray this in the name of your Son, the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.